it's where Clubhouse Kids has been.
Okay, so it sounds to me like it's been covered and everything's all set, so I was fine with your response with Kate's answers to you, so.
Yep.
As long as she's okay, I'm okay.
And then the other question that came up a couple weeks ago was about budgeting. There is $3,500 in the budget for grants. And if all of the grants come in at their max number, we're going to be close to that or just over. There is contingency money in the teen camp too, that is there. I don't know if we could use that or not.
$1,900? Well, I mean, the town would have to, I mean, it falls to the town to fill in the gap. So I am, you know, once I do some of the other, all the other things that I've done this week, and they're copious in numbers, I do want to take a look at this. I mean, our how would you say registrations are?
Well, we met last night, and right now we have 33 registered campers as of last night, and two of them are teen campers, and the rest are probably. Of those 33, of the 31, more than half of them have signed up for the full 8 weeks.
What is that compared to last year?
We are behind where we are last year.
That's what I thought.
And we discussed there are two reasons for that. Number one, last year we had a cutoff day of May 15th for an early bird registration in which people would save money if they registered by May 15th. And we were much more gung-ho and on the ball about getting flyers out last year. With the new teen program, we've gotten flyers out for that. We have not as yet gotten flyers out for Camp Raleigh to the schools. And that is a project that we were supposed to do today. One of our chairs had to miss last night's meeting and didn't bring the flyers she said she was going to bring. So they all went out by email today.
So what is the numbers compared to last year? How much are you off?
I'm not sure at this point. Last year we had roughly 70 campers signed up for Camp Raleigh for 8 weeks.
And
not all of them came all 8 weeks. We started off strong, and by the end of the summer, we were averaging between 30 and 50 on a daily basis.
But you only have
33 right now.
33 right now.
So and between 31 in Camp Raleigh and 2 in teen camp. And I know there are another half dozen, another 6 to 8, I would say, that are not signed up, that are like committee members' children, that
yes.
We have not had the motivation yet to sit down, or some of us have sat down and we've played with the numbers, and we're just trying to figure out the funding on our own ends to get it paid for. There are, I have also sent an email out today that I picked up my son from school, and there are a couple envelopes over there waiting for us to pick them up. So there might be a couple more at the school that we have not yet been received.
We've got one right here that I haven't done. So she's going to go, I'm going to pay for all 8 weeks, but she's not going to go all the way.
Yeah, and like myself, my husband and I just sat down over the weekend and decided we're sending our son for 3 weeks. 1 week each month.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the other thing was is that for the teen camp, a lot of kids are waiting to see when they sign up so that they'll sign up with their friends.
So if you only have two, are you going to pursue still having it?
Teen camp.
Teen camp?
Well, one of the committee members said that she is going to sign up her two kids, one or two kids, and she doesn't know, she's trying to figure out which weeks. And then another one said she's going to sign it up. And it's something we have to look at and discuss.
Do you have like a minimum number? Mm-hmm. For sort of go, no go on the teen camp?
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to that question.
It would be a good one to bring to the committee, I think.
Because you have dedicated staff for that program, correct?
Yes.
Except I have two. That isn't going to pay for it.
Our budgeting numbers that we did in December was based on a minimum of 10.
Teen.
And I believe a max of 20. So we were shooting to get 10.
So you got to find 8 more kids then.
Yeah.
Really,
temp, full-time ones, so you have for the whole period it's open, right?
Yeah, so.
Not just staggered weeks.
Yeah, so the, what is the equivalent of?
Yeah.
Of 10 signed up per week is what we're.
10 signed up per week, yeah.
So, if for some reason you have to cancel it, you can, with the staff that were going to be hired just for the team that we rolled into, is there room for them? Do you have enough staff as it is for the smaller kids?
At the moment, we have, we just dismissed this, I believe we have 10 staff signed up, for Camp Raleigh.
Yeah.
That does not include the director and the assistant director.
Okay.
And of those 10, I believe they told me, that at least two of them were part-time.
Okay.
So that they would work each other off.
Yeah.
And, come up with full-time, and then, we had also discussed that the team camp, staff could go into Camp Raleigh if needed, and it looks like there's 1 week in July that we have had 3 to 4 staff already asked for that time off that we are going to need.
I can imagine it's probably the week that my daughter's not going.
Fourth of July.
Yeah, right, it's in the middle of the week, right, so it's a weird.
Actually, it's the week after.
Yes, oh, it's really?
The week after the staff have, a lot of staff have requested off. A couple of them have been given the time off, and a couple of them have been told, from my understanding, we have to wait and see how many campers we have.
Sure.
Before we can give you any time off, and then, what else did they say last night? So, the other thing with the team camp is if we have to push it back a week, that might, to start date, that might be ideal, because the assistant director is a teacher in Maine, and she is still in school.
Still in school.
The first week of camp.
That'll make it difficult for her to do it.
So, we came up with a couple contingency plans last night, if we started the first week, what we would do.
It sounds like, I mean, we obviously have a lot of questions, but it's promising that you're all thinking about this, trying to figure these things out.
Everybody's thinking about, you know, trying to make sure it's successful, so that's a good sign, and.
Thank you.
Keep hoping that those registrations come rolling in.
And the chair of my committee wanted to know, if anybody hears of transportation grants, to provide transportation for kids, we would love to hear about it on the rec committee, because we would like to reduce the price for the team camp and get more kids involved.
Okay.
And our biggest expense rate is transportation.
Transportation, cool.
And who do you use? You use,
The first student.
The one that the school uses, right?
First student.
Yeah, first student.
We've helped each other with.
What size?
Well, I guess, our last ex officio looked into smaller buses, but they were gonna cost more than that.
You might check with CNJ to see if they would contribute a small, a van and a, one of their small drivers for maybe ones or two.
Small buses are used a lot in the summertime because of, summer school and stuff like that, so that might have been why that they are more expensive to use. Versus the great big ones that they probably wouldn't use necessarily.
And what we did last year is we had a flat rate of X dollars per hour. So it didn't really matter, like, how far you went, you booked them for.
Oh, I see.
Time period.
Time period.
Right.
I believe what it was, but I.
They stick around while you're at the.
I know that when we were doing an RFP, where, you know, there was the investigative.
State needs thing.
Yeah, and there was an investigative day, you know, where they.
Right, right.
That CNJ offered to drive them around, Mike offered to drive them around, you know, something that would fit 5 or 6 people, so I don't know what sizes they have, and it may not be convenient, but that may be an easy way for them to do, provide some additional help. I don't know.
So that is what I have for you.
Excellent, thank you so much. And as usually happens when I have all this paper, I have no idea about what the agenda is.
We're on, that's our.
Vision for RAP.
Oh, think that I'm still just processing and have not looked at the plan in New Hampshire, so I think.
Table it is.
Table, we're tabling that. MS4 permitting, I'm meeting with the stormwater group in the next couple of weeks, we've got to get working on that. And I'm also this week, which is really what I'm gonna have to do before I can get to any, just about any. Anything else is the 2017 report.
Right. The, it's the same folks, right, Paul and Mike and Rob, I think.
Slightly different.
Okay.
So it's Paul Gasol, Michael Point, Nate Mears.
Oh, Nate.
He left last year, so he's not no longer on it. Road agent to George. John Ordway is on it, I'm delighted.
As an engineer.
Yes, and Mike and me.
I love the one engineers volunteer this time.
Oh, my God. Yeah, so there are actually three engineers on that.
And lawyers.
And lawyers, right.
There are three engineers now on the stormwater thing, so that's great. What scares me is, I can do the report for last year, that's not an issue. What scares me is the notice of intent that's due in October. I don't know how much work there is involved, and I know that the Seacoast Stormwater Coalition is working on trying to help.
Right.
I'm not clear what parts yet are they're gonna be able to provide to us. So there's a lot of unknown, but at least I need to get the stormwater committee together. I need us to know that this is, we're gonna need to get this thing done. And it's unclear to me right now exactly what the big, there are too many unknowns. I feel that there are some risks there, but I can't quantify them, I can't qualify them.
If there are pieces that you'd like us to handle for you, for others, no, I know you've been doing it for us, but.
Absolutely, I'm very confident about the report for 2017, it's this new permit that, you know, and I, there is an outreach committee that I'm serving on as part of that coalition. And they're gonna, what I'm hoping is that this group comes up with the pat answers for us to fill in the section on outreach. There's a section on outreach, there's a section on outreach and education, there's a section on business practices, you know, so we would, you know, we get George to do this. The good news is that the first year, it's, our requirements are sound reasonably minimal. It's the best that I can say. And, you know, yes, we'll have to step some things, things will have to get stepped up. You know, but last year was just so busy with our projects, our, you know, all of our long-term projects. You know, I've had some health issues and so, you know, we have a shallow bench and it tells under these circumstances, unfortunately. All right, so I think we're done with the, are we done with those standing, I mean, the.
Oops, I think.
Did I miss that?
Whatever day doesn't rain this weekend, we're not gonna go out, so.
Okay, so you're gonna try to do the perambulation?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, initial conversation regarding meeting twice monthly. I did write to the municipal association about the zoning ordinance that talks about the select board authorizes, authorizes, authorizes.
Yeah.
Margaret wrote back a lengthy thing, I didn't really process it, so, did I forward it yet?
I don't recall.
Okay, if you haven't, I probably haven't even forwarded it, it came later on today. So, it's possible that you haven't even seen it, so I will forward it along and we'll just cogitate on that. All right. There's a letter in front of me. Oh, yeah, this is the thing, I had questions similar to Denise's. This is the person on Stockdale who's doing the second driveway.
Yeah.
So the first question, it's written as if Tom is going to sign it, which is fine unless we feel we want the board to sign it. But it says, this is a follow-up to the letter dated April 9th, requesting you to contact this office in regards to the use of an unlawful driveway from the public right-of-way to the above referenced property without the required building permit. We'll get back to your question about building permit because it's mine as well. The driveway is a violation of ordinance 1501, safety of public ways, from the code of the town of Rollinsford. Therefore, you are hereby directed to cease and desist any further use of the driveway until such time as you contact the select board concerning this matter and a building permit is issued. I did have Caroline add, there's no guarantee that such a building permit would be approved. Failure to comply with this directive may result in legal action. The following text is from the referenced ordinance, and what it refers to is that, you know, they can appear in the Circuit Court of Dover District where the fine should be $100 daily. So, you can read this yourself to see whether it's okay to have Tom sign it, whether you want us to sign it. So my question to Caroline was, what I understood from Ed Jansen that people don't have, aren't permitted to have second driveways. That when they build, they're allowed to have a driveway onto a public way. But there may not be any ordinance against that. That's why.
So say that again. I'm not trying to follow.
Well, when I was, I don't know if whether you were there or it was Patrick Carroll, but
okay.
Jim, it was either Jim Barry or Mike Gibbons.
Gibbons
came to us. Maybe they both came. And their driveway is a right of way, you know, from Locust, I think, right down to their property.
Okay.
But they will occasionally get deliveries on Foundry Street up to their property.
Yeah.
And so when we were doing some work on Foundry Street, they were upset that the swale that we'd made was making it difficult. And Ed Jansen said, you are
taking out that drive.
Well,
it
wasn't
an
official driveway, just
right,
that people would drive, they would sort of drive through.
That's where that clearing is, right? Where they
yes.
things that go up that way.
Yeah.
Oh, I see, okay.
And Ed said, you don't have a permit, you know, you have your one driveway, and that's what the town
right.
gives you, blah, 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 and
right.
he got all uppity.
Animated.
Yeah, he got animated, yes.
Right.
And so, maybe there is no ordinance against a second driveway, but there's still, we must have setbacks and other kinds of things having to do with driveways. So they would.
Do we have as part of the it's not zoning, it's part of.
Housing standards?
It's
part of what?
So the site review or subdivision regulations. Subdivision
mm-hmm.
regulations.
So we need to see, that's why I said, Caroline, you've got, it's not just that they have to do a building permit, they could do a building permit, we can still deny it, and we need
right.
to.
Well,
my question was, it's
still going to go over a sidewalk, and how is that right?
So what would need to happen, I believe, they would need to make an application to us, and we would refer them to the planning board. And then the planning board would go through that with them. It would need to be a curb cut. If it's approved, if it's a legitimate need and they meet all the requirements, the planning board says, sure, you can have one. There would be requirements to do a curb cut and all of that. They'd have to come back to us, and we would work out those details of how they would do that because they're going over the town sidewalk
yeah.
and all that.
So
it's not as simple as just, oh, they're going to give them a building permit and yeah, they're going their merry way. I think. I don't want to speak with Caroline, but I didn't ask her, but I'm guessing that she put that in there as sort of the first step, but
it was
this
Tom.
Is what you would, or Tom, rather, Tom, not Caroline, Tom, I'm looking at the last name, no, looking at the last name,
oh.
sorry, Tom Clark, I put that in there because that's the first step,
mm-hmm.
and we would explain to them, okay, well, you make this application, and then we will refer you to the planning board,
mm-hmm.
instead of just saying you got to go to the planning board, because there should be a step before that, in this case.
I mean, because
I drove down the street yesterday, I think it was, just to double check that I drove by to make sure there wasn't a curb cut there. And to make sure there were actual curb cuts all along. Because,
mm-hmm.
like, if you go up to Wentworth Street, the new road pointing at you, pick a loop on sorry. I don't believe there are curb cuts there. There's, like, this Cape Cod berm that they had to drive over to get into their driveway. Remember, I don't think Denise was on the board yet. And people were putting like these shims, remember these tar
mm-hmm.
shims, so they didn't have to drive over and bottom out their cars.
Oh, that
but
it was only going to be temporary
because
it,
the road
it was
not
within
finished
it
yet.
Was within the Chinburg property.
Right.
It, so what really didn't pertain, they were still managing the road situation there. So
it's not finalized yet.
It wasn't a finalized.
It will be brought
thing.
Up to. It won't be an issue once the driveways and the roads are corrected,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. But
so
this road
sure.
is completed. Yeah. That's my larger point. This road is completely, so there are actual curb cuts where there need to be.
Yeah.
Yes, it's still just.
But it was established when the development was established.
For sure.
So what he has is one side, he has
a. He's got a driveway.
But he just, because he had multiple
cars,
he just used the other side of his house to park them, which, if you didn't go over the sidewalk, I don't see a problem with that. You're using your lawn to be a driveway, whatever, but I don't know that we should allow that.
Correct, and we have sent letters. We have sent letters to Fourth Street, we have sent letters to South Street saying, you cannot drive over our sidewalk to get to.
Even if it, we would still want there's still a planning process for a second driveway.
Mm-hmm.
Even if it didn't cross over, and there probably would be no legitimate reason to deny it, but there was still a process they'd have to go through.
And they have to pay for it.
Right, and I think these folks need to understand that as well. I mean, it's not just, they've got the
added
sort of.
So Michael, would you say.
Problem of going over a.
So would you say that, Michael, that the building permit may not be the first step?
No, I think they may need to make an application to the select.
To us, and then we would refer them to the planning board depending on what we see.
Correct.
But they would be told by either us or the planning board that the steps in order to make this a legal situation is at your expense.
Right, it's not at ours, right.
To have the driveway or the sidewalk cut out and make a real driveway.
Well, I think that's just it, Denise.
But it has to be they have to pay those expenses.
Right, you're absolutely right. And the way the roads and sidewalks, all these things are laid out, certain parts of them are laid out in certain ways to bear certain loads, right?
Mm-hmm.
So.
And we want to ask George.
Right, so George will need to be consulted in that. That's why we really need to go to planning.
What is this, you know, how does this affect, I mean, so it isn't.
It's not just a simple.
It's not just a simple building permit. That's why I did ask Caroline to make it sound like it's not just.
Guaranteed.
It's not just they just have to apply for something.
Right.
There's a whole process.
And Tom is going to be the signatory, and I think that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
I think Tom can help walk these folks through this process too, if they need. And I think that's a legitimate use to.
I mean, we are copied as well as the town attorney, which is
performing. Right.
So we're okay.
I just want to make sure it wasn't an automatic giving a building permit on something that clearly you're going to open up a can of.
Exactly. So why don't you read the paragraph that I specifically said, Caroline, you've got to add something that this is no, it's not necessarily going to happen just because they fell out a building permit.
Does that serve?
I don't know these folks. I mean, this isn't. Yeah, I don't know what their situation was before, if they had some sort of, I mean, the email that the gentleman sent back, and it may have been forwarded to us, or maybe he called the office, he said he claims he's been doing this for 15 years or something, but I mean.
Well, I think he
I mean, so I understand, but it's not relevant.
Doesn't make it right.
That was my point.
Right.
That was my larger point, just because he's.
We're sorry, but.
But.
It's, and there's no limit to.
Could be damaging. Not just
right,
the
fact
that
us or prior boards chose not to follow up on it doesn't mean that once a board does decide to,
it's
still within our legal rights. And
crossing the sidewalk business isn't the new part of the ordinance, right? It was discharging water and stuff under
mm-hmm.
was what we changed a couple of years ago.
Well, I don't know this. By the time we actually passed it, it included the over the sidewalk. I'm not sure that we. That poor thing went through so many whatever's before.
Yes.
I don't know that it was actually an ordinance that got amended. I think by the time it actually got passed, it had the sidewalk piece in it. But whatever, it certainly has now. That's the. So if you could post it, madam, that says it's fine for Tom to sign it and send along, that would be super. Thank you. I don't know why it was sitting out here in the open and not in a folder, but oh, I know, because Caroline said if we wanted to change it to a board signature, but she's long gone, and I think we're fine with Tom. So, all right, so Mike.
Yeah, okay. So we have Thank you again for certainly made life a lot easier tonight. First permit we have, actually the only permit I think we have, some other things, but, is 2018-047, 10 Nordic Lane. That's 90. Just so everyone's clear. Looks like new construction slash repairs. Repair old decking and add on to existing deck. So it should say alteration actually, but and level access to pool using state building code. So they're adding on to their deck that's an existing deck and replacing sections into the links up to the pool, I guess. So it's been reviewed. It's $125 fee.
Ever show up in here?
I'm starting to get cold. I don't know. We're rather near the end, so hopefully. I don't know.
Turn it on.
I don't even know where it
Oh, I can explain that if you'd like, because I was the one who did this.
Okay, I'm just going to leave the warm for you. Oh, you want to do it? You can do it.
Yes. So, our tax collector is about to send out tax bills, and she is not the actual saying okay to the town warrant belongs to the board. So she needed a board member to actually press the button. So I was here today pressing the button. And it says, I'll read it because it's asking for all of our signatures. It's the tax collector's warrant, property tax levy. In the name of the state, it says to Andrea Cass, in the name of the state, you are hereby directed to collect the property taxes in the list herewith committed to you, amounting to the sum of $3,249,032, and with interest at 12% per annum, which is our standard one, from July 2nd, 2018, thereafter, on all sums paid on or before that date. So the tax bills that are going out for 3.2, which should be exactly half of what we did in December. We further order you to remit all monies collected to the town treasurer or to the town treasurer's designee as provided by RSA, blah, 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 at least on a weekly basis or daily, whenever tax receipts total 1,500 or more. Given under our hands at Rollinsford, New Hampshire, this 21st day of May in 2018.
So this is just us telling you to do it?
It's to do her job.
Your job?
Yes.
Okay.
And this is the, so I'll let you both look at this. This is how that sum is arrived at. And you can take a look at that, and then I'll hand it to Michael to look at.
Yeah, how much was that sum? $3 million?
The $3,249,032.
Okay.
Okay, and you've seen it, so I'll give it to you to see if you're ready to sign it. And Mike, here's some of the details associated with that.
And also in line with that, advisory form that all tax collectors are supposed to fill out every year, and Andrea always does, that just says when the final tax bill was mailed for the previous year. So then the state makes her fill out, and the last year was November 10th.
Oh, I see. So, okay, so it's an FYI.
So it sort of goes along with the current warrant. So. And the other thing we have in here, I think is from the town clerk. She's asking to get one of those drop boxes where you can put your, I'll just read what it is, one of these things.
Like your overdue library books, or when the library's closed?
I guess, but not quite as long, I don't think. But,
for?
It's for landlords use them, so the tenants can pay their rent, they just leave them in the box. Says that this would be very helpful to residents to drop payments in after hours, their property taxes, car registrations, dog licensing, building permit payments, resident taxes, summer rec payments, et cetera.
Where would this be located?
I don't know any more than what, because many towns are using these, and we would, we have had many requests for one. I don't know, it's $201. So I would suggest we maybe ask some more questions before we act on it, so.
Yeah, I mean, I think the idea is certainly a practical one and a good one, but we need to figure out where.
Where will we do it?
Where is it going to go?
I think it's danger ready to happen, sorry.
Because of the thievery?
Lock it down, but, yeah, I mean.
Stealing it, yeah. I think it would be inside, right? It would have to be inside.
How can it be inside if nobody's here?
What good does that do?
Well, because the office isn't always open when there might be meetings or things. I mean, they're planning on putting it outside.
It looks like a post office box.
Not gonna, not a good idea, so.
I mean, it looks like it's outdoors.
It's out, it says outdoor.
Yeah.
I think it's a bad idea too, if it's outside, but that's why I wanted to ask some more questions, but.
So that's our primary concern, is the thievery aspect.
Well, I just, I think that, I think maybe this.
I mean, if you would hacksaw it.
Yeah. Right.
You know, you could take the whole box with you.
But I think it's because of town office hours being more limited than they used to be, especially in the summer months. And I think that that may.
Might be more of an issue.
Yeah, that might be the issue, but, I mean, I don't want to encourage not having required office hours, so I'm not really for it. If you want to mail them, they can mail it.
It's safer to mail them anyways, so.
I mean, if that's what they're looking for anyways, for people to mail the registrations in, put a stamp on it and have it go into the office.
Yeah, it'd be safer.
Yeah, I just don't think that's, to me, it doesn't look very safe.
Okay.
If it's outdoors, that definitely.
It's definitely, I think it's meant to be outdoors.
Yeah, I look at the picture more,
You've got me persuaded, just, you know, send it by mail. You know, as I was walking out today, I was late, and so the town hall was closed, and a young woman was walking in, and we said, oh, sorry, it's closed. There was nobody, I don't know what she wanted to do, but she had a handful of, like, cash. And it just harkened back to a comment I made in the, that you'll see in the response to the auditors who they want us to only accept checks at the transfer station.
Mm-hmm.
And and it's just my response, it's just the draft, so it's for you to look at, but my response was, you know, we have many residents, young or old, who don't
accept checks,
who don't do cash.
Yeah,
I mean, who don't do checks, I'm sorry, who don't do checks.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And told some debit cards or.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Or this young woman had a handful of cash, and I almost asked her, so, is this because you don't have a checkbook? But I had to get home, so I didn't. But, so anyway, you know, when you read that in the response, you'll see what we can do. I did call the town of Lee because Jody had said that the town of Lee, the transfer station, had a kiosk, a little machine that you could feed either cash or a credit card and get a ticket for like whatever, 20 bucks or whatever, whatever it was, your fee, to cover your fee, and you'd hand in that ticket. So I called asking about that and the company and this and that. She says, well, you know, we're considering removing it. It's been a headache.
A headache, yeah.
And the materials, the tickets, and the this and the that have turned out to be more expensive than it's worth. So there you go. So I don't know what to do about that. So if you guys
do we want to put denied on it?
Just say the board has serious questions and is not ready to accept this. And see what if somebody wants to come back to us. I mean, if you want to put anything more than that, I'll feel free to please. Like, we prefer they mail them in. You know, when you put cash, when you deposit cash in the bank, I mean, it's going into some, you know, in a much better secured thing.
So the board not ready to accept, more detail needed, mailing seems to be the preference.
Also,
all right.
Thank you.
Are you done?
Yeah, I'm just gonna.
Oh, you're gonna put it in your folder?
Well, because this folder goes back to the front office.
Okay, that's the, okay. I will have completed 6 years here, will not have figured out the folder system.
You know, it's funny, because you're gonna have building, you're gonna have, yeah.
Yeah, I know, POs come from everywhere.
POs from the clerk in there, so I don't get it.
Yeah, that's a guy.
Well, I've been told this one goes from there.
All right, so I have a PO number 1450 for B&B Printing for 1,400 newsletters, higher quantity due to new mailing system. I'm not quite sure I understand what that is, but.
I can tell.
Okay, for the price is $232.25.
I second.
Okay.
All right, and so our question is, why is it higher? And Salma, you say you can answer that question.
Because we have to have more, because with the new tax billing, each bill gets mailed separately.
Oh.
Whereas before.
You bundled them?
Yes.
Okay.
So because of the new way we're doing it, they don't bundle the bills, they get like four bills instead of.
Each, you know, if you have six pieces of property, you're gonna get six separate bills rather than having them all combined.
Oh, I see, oh, I see. I see.
And why did they change that?
Because they're not doing it here.
Oh, okay.
They're doing it.
That's right.
Mail service.
That's right.
Mail service.
And the mail in Manchester.
Yep.
But in the future, we're thinking of having the printing actually happen there as well. This is a.
No, I will not. I can't give up B&B. I don't have the, I don't have the expertise to put it together.
You're talking about this, you're talking about just the newsletter.
She's talking about the tax bills.
Oh, 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 I was thinking about the tax bills. I'm sorry.
Oh, they are being printed elsewhere now.
Yes, okay, this is just the newsletter that, okay, I understand that.
B&B puts it together for us, like does.
Does more of the layout.
Layout for us, gratis, and then we just pay for the printing. Michelle does the layout for us, it's great, so.
Well, she doesn't do the lay, I do the layout.
She puts it, I thought she put it together for us, no?
She makes it pretty for us.
Well, isn't that the.
That's sort of.
That's different, it's different.
Okay.
I'm ready, did you actually move it?
Yes, and I second.
Okay. Are there any other questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Salma, it looks nice. So you did a good job, and the prettifying did a good job, so.
Yep.
It's good, thank you.
All right, I have purchase order 1290 payable to Martha Kuchar for Doe Burial Ground Spring Cleanup for a total of $135.
There's a quiet second over there. Comments or, this is the.
Why is the postage mentioned?
It just says to make the check out to Martha. She must have wrote it on it before someone did the PO.
Please pay this bill when you are doing bills. Please pay a bill to Martha Kuchar. So it's, this is one of those private little cemeteries that we still have to take care of. I don't even know where it is, but we've done this in the past, so I had a motion, I had a second, I called the question.
Chief Justice Doe is buried.
Really? Where is it? Do you know?
I thought it was off of Saga.
No.
Or in that area.
It is.
Yeah, it's on that side.
Didn't you, you felt over there?
I've never been there, but my husband helps, because he's a cemetery trustee.
It's down, it's off of, in that area of Saga, right?
It's on private property along the river.
Yeah.
And so very limited number of people go there.
No, you see the on the side of Portland Avenue is this Charles Stubbing Doe, where it was the middle name was. It was the Chief Justice of the State Supreme Court.
Huh.
That way down by the river, he grew up there. Jesse Doe.
Jesse Doe's that same family.
Daughter.
Ah, well, thank you for that historical note, Michael.
Second, one of two women that were first elected to the state legislature.
That's excellent. All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
She's not buried there, though. She's been conquered.
Whatever.
Very prominent family.
I have a correspondent from David Scott on behalf of Terry Bennett, looking to have a meeting set up. I think I saw a letter on our email as well, that they were gonna set up a meeting with.
Oh, it was Chad, right, so is this.
Yeah, but this is to the Board of Selectmen.
Just an FYI, so that we know that this is happening?
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Also, I have, oh, this is that, the engineering contract, isn't this?
Is that the general services?
I believe so.
Yes, I asked Caroline to print it out, so if some of you would like to see a printed version of this, here it is, and this is, and of course, we would sign it if there are no changes, so it's up to you. I read it online, I made my comments to, you know, this is the section.
Is that the one that's been changed?
Article 12, insurance has been changed, and Caroline is sending it to Primex to make sure that the client's piece still is something that we provide. And the other question I asked him was on markup, because, I mean, clearly the prices have gone up, I mean, that's just the nature of the beast. But under Exhibit C, he says, for the town of Rollinsford, Quill Tanner does not mark up direct reimbursable expenses or the cost of sub-consultants. And so I wanted to make sure that I fully understood that, because somewhere else it says they charge 10% above direct charges. So I said, so if I'm reading this correctly, then you are exempting the town of Rollinsford from a 10% indirect cost that you normally charge for direct costs and sub-consultants. So that was the other question that I asked.
You're back from the sign us.
Yeah, yes. But if you wanted to see a printed copy, this is your choice.
We have it on email, right?
Yes, yeah, yep.
Thank you.
Do you want me to file this?
Just, yeah, keep, say, keep in folder, because if there are no changes, then we'll, their CEO has already signed it, so we could sign it.
Okay.
Is this your budget that you want?
That's all I have.
I have no idea what this is. Was it in your folder?
No, it was just sitting here.
Oh, is that the one? Yes, it is the one. I'm gonna need my magnifying glasses, but it still says, you know, zero, it still net zero, you know, revenue expenses. General services agreement.
The general service agreement.
And it will, it's a two-year agreement.
On-call general engineering services.
Yeah, that's it, that's its exact name. And it is for 2 years, which shouldn't violate anything, because there are no costs associated with it. It can be terminated at any point by either party. So it itself doesn't bind us to anything. It just says, if we sign a task order later on for it, that specifies a specific task that has its own budget, it will follow the general terms and conditions that are in that.
Gotcha.
Are we really?
I hope so.
Meetings this week, we sort of talked about them.
I'm gonna go walking in the woods along the road on Sunday or Monday.
Well, I just have my.
Saturday.
Yeah, we're talking CIP spreadsheet.
That's all I have.
And I'm trying to get the stormwater, I don't know when that will happen. Oh, I do, and there is a stormwater committee coalition meeting on Wednesday. I just feel I'm not gonna be in great shape to go, but George said he would be going, so.
Not that I wanna encourage an additional meeting, but do we feel that we have to meet?
Oh, that's the other question, yes. Well, we can hold off, you know, we can make the decision, you know, via email.
Okay, so we're not going to meet on Monday? And if we feel that there's something coming up that makes us meet, we could either do Tuesday or Wednesday.
Yep, a 24-hour notice to the town.
Okay.
So that, you know, if there's something, I think we've said that administratively we're managing the grants. That we've already approved the concept of the grants, and so we'll just do that. So we, you know, as long as one of us can come by and sign whatever needs to be signed. Caroline said she might be concerned about building permits.
For next week?
Yeah. Oh,
yeah.
So.
I, just so you're aware, I'm not available on Thursday or Wednesday or Thursday night. So if we need to meet, we need to be Tuesday.
Okay.
Or you can do it without me. I mean, that's fine.
That would be the best anyway, because, you know, if we meet on Thursday and then the following month, I mean, it's too close to their.
Fair enough. I just wanted to throw it out there for them.
Yeah.
I have something both those evenings.
Okay.
Okay.
Sounds good. All right. Are we at community input? Anything? All right, board, are we ready to rock and roll?